Hey everybody, Sue Hitzmann, creator of The Melt Method. Welcome to another Tuesday Talk. I am here today with one of my besties, Aaron Alexander from Los Angeles. He is the founder and creator of The Align Method. Aaron, how you doing?
Hello. I'm very well. I am shivering here as I'm talking to you. So that's...
I'm grateful
for my shivers.
just came back from a workout. Maybe we should jump right in and talk about that. You know, like usually yeah. when I follow you on Insta and Facebook, I see a lot on Instagram, and usually you're like either pushing a very large tire or some very large dumbbell and swinging it over your head, or like playing some massive like medicine ball game with another person. And now that social distancing is here and there's no gyms open, what are you up to? What are you pushing around, dude? What are you doing to keep yourself fit and buff like you always are?
Well, I've learned, which I mean, I've had this lesson lots of times. Pretty much every time I get sick, I have this lesson. I'm sure you've had this lots of times as well. Just the value of the rest side of fitness. You know, and so during this time, I've been doing not a ton. I mean, in the beginning, it was like just a lot of rest and like, you know, literally sleeping more. And just because mainly my social activity is like fitness. And when I wasn't able to socialize, it translated to less fitness. And I found I became much stronger as a product of that. So that's one thing that I've learned throughout the whole experience, is that I don't need to do as much to get strong and to really like feel my best. And the things that I have been doing have been a lot more technically focused, you know, so a lot more like yoga and mobility things. And just really focusing on like slow technical movements and exploring range of motion in my house. And then I just got done doing a pool workout thing with a person with a backyard, their client. And, you know, so we were going into the pool and combining various variables. So in this case, it was like raining a little bit as well. So it was cold. The pool's like 61 degrees. We're doing breath holds. We're doing exercise. We're outside. So we're exposing our skin to the sun. We're having to think as we're going through that, navigating through different obstacles, you know, so compounding a lot of variables all at once, it comes down to essentially like, you know, Stephen Porges stuff and play. You know, if you can put yourself up into that play part of fitness, you know, I describe it in my book as the, the king of the movement hierarchy, or, you know, it's like the top. If you can start to integrate some of those, stack those variables, and then eventually arrive at play, is really what I'm really interested in. That's kind of what I've been doing today.
Well, and that'd be another thing too, to talk about, you know, your book just came out just a couple months ago, and it seems like it was a couple months ago. It might be a little bit more than that, but it seems like just not too long ago. But talk a little bit about the Align Method and some of the philosophies that you have, because a lot of the stuff that I really dig about what you're talking about is just how to move your body and how to move it often and how to move it well and incorporate it into every facet of your life, whether you're at the grocery store or you're, you know, going to the gym. You kind of have this 360 view of the whole world as your playground and an opportunity to move.
Yeah. I love that. That's what you get from it. Yeah, that's exactly. That's the thesis of the book. You know, it's like every moment throughout your day truly is an opportunity, if that's the way that you perceive it. You know, and Joan Vernikos, you're probably familiar with her. She's a NASA researcher she was at NASA for like 35, 40 years, some extended period of time. And she was you might know her title better than I do. I think it's like the director of life sciences or health sciences at NASA. She was studying astronauts, the effect of gravity on astronauts in space. And what she found was that the astronauts that would have regular bouts of exercise throughout the day, compared to the people that have these like blowout kind of, you know, hardcore CrossFit style, you know, with resistance bands, stuff like that type workouts in one chunk, and then kind of be passive throughout the rest of the day, like a lot of culture. The people that would have that blowout workout and a lot of passivity, they would end up going into this kind of like rapid aging process from zero gravity. And then the ones that would say, no, let's just do little drips of fitness throughout the whole entire day, those people would actually fare very well. And so what I am suggesting in the Align Method and just life in general is, how can we make it so that our experience at, you know, in the office or at home or work or travel or any of that all of those are a bunch of opportunities, little micro opportunities for us to start to pay attention to the way that we move in our bodies. And if you start to ever so slightly change your perspective on what fitness means and make it be more something of who you are as opposed to a thing that you do, I think it's the fountain of youth. And if you can come to that point of like, wow, like I'm here at the bank, like what can I do? Oh, I'm with my kid. Okay, well, may I put him in this position? Oh, there's a dog down there. Oh, maybe I'll get down to the ground and work with that. You know, we're going to play fetch on the ground. If you just change your mindset ever so slightly and you have the know-how on how to do that, like the basic fundamental principles, how to do that, you know, your whole life truly becomes an opportunity. That's essentially what, you know, what I wrote the book about.
I love that. That's such a great way to say it too. And I always feel like just even changing your idea about what fitness is, if, you know, because I think you are a lot like me. Like I feel we have so much in common in the idea of what fitness is. It's just part of your life. It's, you know, it's a part of what makes you feel good. It's what makes you get out there and to do things. So if your whole world's your playground, you kind of can't not find something to do to give yourself that moment to do a little extra to drive a little more focus into your movements, you know?
I think it's great. And then in relation to like focus, you know, recognizing that you have all of these tools at your disposal. It's not just mechanical tools of, oh, I could maybe hip hinge when I pick that thing up off of the ground, or maybe I'll do a lunge at the bank or stand up on one foot. Those are very kind of like obvious, like mechanical things that a person can do. But also acknowledging that your visual muscles, for example, there's a bunch of little kind of wormholes we can go down with this, but just your visual muscles, that's literally a part of your exercise. You know, and so you could start thinking of those, the way that you use your eyes, if you're looking out into the distance and you're using more of that panoramic vision, you're relaxing the ciliary muscles, and all those muscles can come to a place where they can calm down. That sends that signal through the rest of your nervous system that, oh, okay, Sue's just taking it all in right now. You know, she's be able to sit back and kind of, okay, and it's a time to maybe it's a time to like rest and digest and do all those things. Versus when Sue's focusing down into the cell phone or focusing down, you think of like, imagine someone pulling a bow back and they're really honing down on what they're about to shoot. That takes a lot of focus, and it brings that your autonomic nervous system more into a place of like executive, you know, get stuff done. Okay, here we go.
Exactly.
And so when a person is, and you could hear, even as I'm describing that panoramic vision, and I'm saying, what does that make you? It makes you go kind of, makes you do that. Oh, what did I do with my breath? Oh, I exhaled as I did that. And I had a long, maybe even audible exhalation. Oh, that sounds a lot like yoga. And it sounds a lot like, you know, all sorts of different things where we're teaching these basic principles. You'll see them overlap in all these different modalities or mediums of movement or, you know, awareness. You know, and so just tapping into your awareness of like, okay, I can tap into my autonomic nervous system with my breath and my vision. And there's, you know, there's a lot of other ones as well, but that's just a really nice starting point for people to start to pay attention to. It's all attention. In the end, it's just like, are you paying attention? Yes or no? You know, it's like, okay, cool. I think I'm paying attention. It's like, okay, cool. Do you know what to pay attention to?
Right.
Like, oh, shoot. Okay. Interesting. Tell me more.
Well, and I wonder, you know, when you talk about things like that, I think that there's, especially in this climate, because of what's happened over this last couple of months of just, you know, fear being involved with people's perception of what's happening. I think that we're seeing, you know, not just visually seeing things differently, we're taking information in differently. And now suddenly we're not touching, we're not hugging, we're not connecting. And you know, in just the times I've been out to LA and when I got to hang out with you out at the beach and watching, you know, you do some of the acro yoga and things like that, it's a compelling thing where, you know, especially you guys out in Los Angeles, when you're out at the beach, it's the same thing over here on the East Coast, but it's cold here, you know, I mean, it was probably beautiful out there. And so what are you doing without the beach and all of the connection and how you're seeing people, and how do you feel that's affecting you, as well as how do you think that's affecting your clients? And then how are you guys staying connected if you're not connecting in a live environment?
Yeah. I was reading a thing recently, you know, the David Data, The Way of the Superior Man book. Oh, it's like a popular one. And one of the things he was talking about in there was taking in a woman, you know, and like having the experience of like a beautiful woman, you know, and it's like the way that she makes you feel and kind of like that, you know, maybe you get like some tingles or whatever, and not being attached to proceeding anything beyond just that experience, you know, and really loving and absorbing and embodying that experience. And it was like, oh, like, wow, like, cool. Like, we didn't need to have sex. She doesn't need to be my girlfriend. I don't need her number. Like, we can just walk past each other. I can kind of download that, like, wow, like, I'm really opening myself up to have that experience and really can savor that, as opposed to kind of moving through the world kind of closed off, mm-hmm. you know. And that's what I see with a lot of people at like grocery stores and just in general. I'm like awkwardly, borderline offensively, like nice smiley guy during times of this, you know. And so I'm like hello.
Well, and it's true. My friend Mike said to me, I'm really having a hard time. Like, you know, you can't even like flirt with somebody at the grocery store. People actually have their eyes down. Yeah, they're not looking at you. I mean, I have a face mask that has a big rainbow lips on them. So you can kind of see that people are like smiling with their eyes through their masks here. But, you know, everybody's got a mask on. And actually our governor has said, if you're going to go out, to wear a mask to protect other people and things like that. And I think, protect them from what? From my non-virus body. But they're like, oh, you might have it. I'm like,
So what I'm kind of getting at is that we can touch each other without having physical touch. In fact, we are touching each other without having physical touch. You know, so there's like the obvious part, which this is kind of a little bit funny to talk about in relation to like the whole virus pandemic stuff, but you are breathing each other in as you go into a room, but like you are attuning to each other's facial expressions and each other's mannerisms, you know. So when I go into a place, I'm literally touching any person that comes in contact with visually. I think it's beyond visual, but you know, like certainly we can 1,000,000% confirm visually, if you look at someone, just by looking at their facial gestures and their mannerisms, that affects the way that you feel, you know. And so when you go into a grocery store, just because we can't grab somebody and you got to keep like a, what do they say, like a llama's distance between each other. So I saw some silly sign the other day. That's fine. But we're still contacting each other through the way that we carry ourselves, you know. So that would be something that I would, you know, recommend for other people if they care to, is just pay attention to what's the facial gestures and physical body gestures that I'm making as I walk into a room, and realizing that I literally am almost like massaging other people's nervous systems with that. And if I go into a room from a place of closed down, shoulders rolled forward, spine hunched forward, you know, wincing kind of in this like, oh, panic, like get the toilet paper. I'm literally, I'm sending that signal throughout the whole entire room.
Exactly. You know?
Yeah, so yes, it's like you got to be responsible for that stuff.
Yes, grabbing toilet paper from people. I see people fighting for that last
roll. People shouldn't be using toilet paper anyway. It's ridiculous. If you ever had some fecal matter on your arm, you wouldn't in 1,000,000 years be like, could somebody grab me a bleached piece of paper to rub this fecal matter? You would hose it off. You would put it under the faucet. You would just rinse it off. So now's a great time for people to just get a bidet, move on with their lives. It's time to grow up, get a bidet.
I hadn't even thought about that, but now that you've said it, you might.
It's ridiculous.
I wonder if the bidet
Bearing poo in yourself.
Maybe more bidets have been sold.
Yeah, my friend Miki Agrawal, Tushy. She's got a good thing. It's not expensive. She lives in New York, actually. Miki, you guys would love each other.
I wonder, do you find that your eating habits are any different with you?
Yeah. Oh man, I'm so much better eater. One thing I'm noticing, I am like compost them like a mofo now, because I'm making like more stews and cutting up veggies and all that stuff. I'm doing everything that I should have been doing for the last 10 years. You know, like you make a big stew, I make a big pot of white rice and I throw a whole bunch of veggies into a pot, put some water in there, spring water, you know, so I'm not getting all like the stuff from the faucet, you know, and I boil all that stuff down. I throw some spices and whatnot, boost the immune system and get the all the feel good kind of hormones gone from the spicy stuff. And then I throw that in the fridge and I'm good for like 4 days, and it cost me like $6. You know, whereas before I was spending all this money driving down to the grocery store and the place, it's like, I'm really paying. And now I realize I'm rambling. I apologize. But I am noticing now, one, the amount of waste that I'm producing at an individual level is becoming less because of the way that I'm cooking, which is amazing. It's good for everyone, including like my own health. But now I'm also becoming extra sensitive to how much more plastic is infused into food, because now everything has to be wrapped and double wrapped. And so those are the things that I'm becoming more sensitive to, which I think could be really helpful if like everyone becomes more sensitive to, because your trash doesn't just go away. Like, just because it's like, we're like babies, you know, it's like peekaboo. Like we, you know, mom moves over and mom just disappears entirely. That's most adult Westerners' belief system of trash. You know, it's like trash man comes. It's like, peekaboo, is it gone? It's like, no, it's not gone. It's coming back.
Coming back, exactly. Well, and it is, I mean, it's actually kind of incredible here in New York, where you usually see piles and piles of garbage. We actually, our emissions are down by 65% in New York City. Our garbage is down. We have had alternate side of the street parking has been suspended for weeks, and the streets still look great. So that should tell you something. I mean, like the Upper West Side where I live is like a ghost town. There's just nobody there right now. They all fled to their summer homes. I'm out at my brother's summer home. but it is kind of an incredible thing when you think about that. And I'm like you, I feel like I've actually, I'm spending more time cooking things that are very warming to the soul with more spices. My mom said to me, I've never eaten so well or so much. And I said, well, just remember, you might be eating more, but you're eating more vegetables. You're eating less chips, right? So that's kind of an exciting thing to just sort of be around my mom and see her instilling good habits, trying to get her out walking and things like that. And so the beaches completely closed? You can't walk on the beach.
I mean, they say that. This feels just like kind of like an adult summer camp type sensation. Like, this is not like going to the beach. It's not, it's just there's signs that says you can't go, but people are walking and whatnot. People aren't surfing, which is kind of a bummer. Is funny, because surfing, I don't see how that's going to, you know.
Where are you going to get coronavirus in the ocean when you're in salt water? Exactly. Yeah. Are you really ever more than 6 feet apart? I mean, you're like really far apart from people. It just, that one kind of tripped me out. I was like, of all things to not do.
Yeah, but no, so as far as like the eyewitness reporting of what's happening in LA, no, people are still walking on the beach and people are still, it's hard to get like, the thing that I find fascinating about the whole thing is that in mainstream media, you see little to nothing about the value of your body's capacity to create antibodies and, you know, like your immune system. There's like no talk of that. It's like, the cure will be here in 12 to 16 months. It's like the cure. It's like, dude, like you are the cure.
Indeed.
Like, indeed. Start paying attention to your body now, you know, go out, maybe take your shirt off and get some sun and maybe get rid of some of those chips and crackers and processed food that's, you know, been down regulating your immune system for the last however long, you know.
I would say, you know, it's not a virus isn't a bacteria, right? Like you can transmit bacteria, but viruses are, it's like, it's not a thing so much like that you're catching. You don't catch a virus. It's an odd thing the way that they're describing how viruses are. And I think that's something that people need to realize. You're right, that the people who are really getting sick are the ones that have terrible immune systems, poor diets, and most of them are just not really doing the due diligence of the body. The body isn't as resilient. And the people who are eating well, you are getting outside, you are breathing fresh air, and you also have a positive attitude and you're keeping calm, right? You're able to weather the storm. I think that this is really important to our own well-being and how our body is just managing the endorphins and the oxytocin and the nice relieving hormones and things of that nature, that we really need to recognize how much our own mindset is also playing a role in our well-being right now more than ever.
And I also wouldn't put, I think it'd be easy to create like a war between like people that think they're healthy and people that, you know, are not, and people that are eating processed fruit roll-ups or whatever. Like, I don't really think it's their fault. You know, like, so it's people, like, we become a product of our environment in large part, you know? And so looking, stepping back and really just examining, you know, what does your home look like? What does your relationships look like? What does your work situation look like? You know, and start looking at what's the environmental stimuli, the impact they have on your organism. You know, and so start, if you're a goldfish and you're in a toxic soup pond pool, you know, you could give that goldfish all the supplements and all the aerobic Tybo workout programs and all that stuff. It's like, you are in this stew. You need to figure that out, you know? And so little subtle things that people could do would be, maybe it's like, you might have a Wi-Fi router near your bed while you sleep at night. Like, maybe get an automatic timer and just turn that thing off every night at 10 PM,
that's right,
you know, and have it turn back on at 7 AM.
That's
you
right.
You know, little things like that are like, no big deal. Maybe you could, in your shower, maybe you could get a little water filter, you know? So now you're not opening up your pores and getting all hot and steamy while you're pouring a bunch of chlorine and fluoride and weird stuff into your pores for you to see, literally absorb that stuff into your bloodstream. You know, looking at little things with like the food that's in your fridge, you know, are you getting all of that processed packaged stuff because you've been habituated to shop in those sections, you know, of the grocery store? Maybe just like almost force yourself to be like, cool, I'm going to shop around the edges. You know, I'm just going to get some, I don't know what's that Romanesco spirally, what, like, grab it. I don't know. We'll see what happens.
That's right.
Like, be adventurous with your eating this week and just put some weird crap in your fridge and see what happens.
That's, you know, a great way to do it. That's what a great thought to do. You know, every time I go to the grocery store, I usually try to buy one thing that I've never bought before.
That's great.
Yeah.
You know, do like that.
A new vegetable that maybe I'm not.
Get a new veggie. It's time.
Something is something different.
And so eat more. This is like a Tony Robbins thing, but I like the eat more watery food. You know, what, like, being vegetables and stuff like that. So when you're putting really, really, really like dense processed stuff, it's like, takes energy for your body to break down. By snapping on a carrot or some celery, or, you know, grabbing an apple or whatever it is, mm-hmm. It's like, you're literally hydrating yourself through that process of eating, as opposed to, you know, dehydrating yourself by eating some dense processed nonsense.
Indeed. Indeed. So one last thing for you. I know you've got your website and you do a ton online. You're so great with social media. You're always out there giving people great stuff to just think about and do. But I'm curious, how can people find you? What are you doing on your website? What kind of trainings or courses or videos do you have for people to find you and check out more about all of your amazing stuff that you're doing?
Yeah. If people are interested in going deeper into understanding the basic fundamentals of self-care, which is a lot what you teach, I go and I actually reference your book in my book, and I recommend people getting the melt roller and going deeper into your stuff. So I think they actually pair really well together. You know, so where I get into more like some of like the breath practices, and, you know, teaching people like how to stimulate their nervous system through breathing, how to calm their nervous system through breathing. How can we make it so that we understand these baseline fundamentals of movement so that we can start to integrate them into our daily lives, the way that we work, the way that we travel, the way we spend time at home. So literally your whole day beats a bunch of opportunities to feel better. You know, so that's what the Align Method book is about. And then we created the Align Method online program, which is the living addendum to the book, where we go into that. And the first week is completely free. People can try it out, check it out. And if they're into that, you know, they get an aligned band. It's like a whole thing. It's a great thing. The first week's completely free. It's really fun. People have been like devouring that since the quarantine. So that's been an interesting thing of like, it's been bittersweet. I'm like, wow, this sucks. But I just wrote a book for this situation. Oh, that's interesting.
Indeed. Well, and I hope everybody listening hears one thing, which seems to be the common thread of so far everybody that I've talked to on these Tuesday talks, is we all agree that the breath is the access point to stimulating your body, to calming the nervous system, to helping autonomic regulation, to create self-regulation, to create self-preservation, and to really stay connected both mind, body, and spirit. It is one of the most important things to do, is to slow down and really become connected to your breath in a new way, because that's really where it all starts for everything from heart rate variability to just your overall calmness. It's important that you try to just change it up a little bit and learn some different breathing techniques and just focus inward. I think that's a super important point, no doubt.
And then also giving yourself the spaciousness to be able to tap into your breath by adjusting the mechanics if it's necessary, which for most people it is necessary.
Indeed.
So it's, so a person can huff and puff and breathe and, you know, do all the things, but if they've never actually learned how to put their body into a position that they're able to access their full respiratory capacity, then it's going to be, you know, kind of like an uphill battle. And through tapping into that breath and the mindfulness and all that stuff, that can subtly start to shift the mechanics into a more natural place. Mm-hmm. You know, so both feed back into each other. My recommendation would just be go from both ends.
So love that. And on that note, hey, everybody, thanks so much again for checking us out on our Tuesday talks. And I'll make sure that you guys have all the information about Aaron Alexander's book and how to find him through the Align Method and everything else that he's doing, so that you can stay connected to Aaron through social as well as his website. Aaron, always wonderful to see you. I send you a huge, massive virtual hug
out
into the universe.
I
look forward to seeing you soon in Los Angeles as soon as it's safe to get out there. You're the first person I'm going to connect with for sure.
As soon as we're told it's safe to get out there.
Indeed.
It might be different things.
Indeed. Thanks so much, guys. See y'all later. Bye. Bye-bye.